Welcome to Criminal Law. My name is Corey Rayburn Young. I'm a professor at the University of Kansas School of Law, and I will be talking to you through a series of lectures about the American criminal justice system. These lectures correspond with a casebook titled Criminal Law that I authored that's an open source Opus Access book that you hopefully have by now. Before getting into the details of the criminal justice system and the basics that I'll lecture about today, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I've been a professor now for a little over 10 years. I've taught criminal law, criminal procedure, and sex crimes as my primary courses. I do research in the area of criminal law and specifically focus on issues of sexual violence. Before that, I was in private practice where I worked on a variety of matters, including Foreign Corrupt Practices Act cases, which is a criminal statute that applies abroad, and did a variety of pro bono work ranging from the Rwandan War Crime Tribunal, worked on training program for the defense bar in Liberia. I also worked on a death penalty case in Florida for quite some time. So I feel free to ask me any questions about my background if you're interested. But for now, I just want to delve into the topic at hand, which is criminal law. Now, of course, everyone here is familiar with the criminal justice system, even if not directly and personally, because our social and cultural media is often very concerned with stories in the criminal justice system. Whether you've watched Law & Order, Law & Order SVU, NCIS, I don't know, is it Los Angeles, CSI, they're virtually every hour of prime time has multiple options for people to watch about our criminal justice system. But of course, those stories that you see, you know, give you some knowledge, and some of it will even be right and be accurate, but a lot of it won't, because the criminal justice system that's portrayed on TV and through other media is often very distilled. Cases are resolved usually within an hour or 40 minutes if we take out commercials. Trials are very straightforward. You know who is guilty, who is innocent. You have a sense of what the just outcome should be. In reality, our system is incredibly slow-moving, where cases can take years to resolve. There are often much clearer doubts about what has actually happened, whether or not somebody is even a criminal. The scope of our criminal law is very clear to police on the TV shows, but the real world is often much muddier. And in fact, I think it's fair to say that across all sorts of ideologies, across partisan lines, there is widespread agreement that in the United States, the criminal justice system is broken. Now, how it's broken, how we should fix it, those are topics that there are, you know, disagreement about. But everyone agrees that there's major, major problems. And of course, the last few years have brought these issues and these defects in our criminal justice system to the fore. Especially, there's been a focus on policing and the use of lethal force, often against vulnerable and minority populations in the United States. But I want to step back just a bit, not to ignore the timely issues, and think about what criminal law means in the United States and similarly situated countries. Because even if it's not enough to know that the criminal justice system is broken, but to understand what is going on and how different aspects of it undermine a sort of our social order, undermine our sense of democracy, and has other negative effects. And this comes from an idea that I'm just going to say is criminal law is foundational, that it's actually an important bedrock of our society. Now, I'm sure every law professor has some version of the story that their course is the best and why it matters the most. And yes, I'm going to do that exact same thing and tell you why my course is the best. But the difference is I'm right, because criminal law is what makes every other aspect of our legal system work, right? When you take a torts class, you learn about civil actions where one person sues another. But hidden in the background is, well, what happens if the person doesn't comply with the judgment? What if they refuse to pay? The answer is the criminal law, right? What happens if somebody violates a contract and there's a breach? How do you resolve that? Well, you resolve it through litigation. And again, it's that threat of criminal law, whether it be the contempt power of courts or other penalties associated with criminality, that makes things work. But our criminal justice system also is, and it's problems are at the core of lots of the other major salient issues of our time. For example, issues of racism and racial discrimination often come to the fore in the criminal justice arena. Political corruption is, many people think is rampant and widespread in the United States, but in many ways that's due to the shrinking of our law of what constitutes bribery. At the same time, there's been an inability or an unwillingness to criminalize certain forms of fraud. And so criminal law there, through its absence, has empowered corrupt forces within our government. There is issues of poverty and wealth inequality tied up into criminal law. A lot of our low-level regulatory misdemeanor-type statutes are focused on punishing people who are poor, who can't pay fines, people who are homeless. When a city passes an ordinance, such as a public sleeping ordinance, that you can't sleep in public, there's little doubt who they are targeting in that regard. It's somebody who needs to sleep in public, somebody without a home. Immigration has become an incredibly salient topic in political discourse since, or even before, 2016. But it also intersects strongly with our criminal justice system, although it didn't used to. Right. Immigration was long thought to be the lifeblood of the United States. It was something that we sought for our growing nation. And criminal law has only really become part of immigration law in the last 30 plus years, where we've started treating people who arrive without documentation or are here without documentation as criminals under certain circumstances. But that wasn't always true. And we could even say that areas of our policy and our government that have little to do with criminal law, things like education, right, environmental policy, healthcare, they've been affected by the criminal justice system as well because our system has expanded enormously in the latter half of the 20th century and beginning of the 21st century. Mass incarceration has taken up more and more of state budgets, and it realized that it is the states that are often the primary governments of interest here because over 90% of our prisoners and people who are in jail and in the criminal justice system are at the state level. The federal system is small by comparison. And state budgets are regularly limited because of the growth of criminal justice allocations, money going to police, money going to prisons, and so forth. So criminal law is incredibly important, right? So if I haven't made, if you don't believe the case by now, I doubt you're going to be sold, but I want you to realize all the different ways that it affects our society, more than they show in, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, which doesn't quite give you a full picture. So we have, just a few substantive issues to get today, and I use the word substantive here with emphasis. But I'm going to give you a little, context for what you need to know in this course going forward. So why did I emphasize the word substantive? Well, in law school, you learn a distinction which isn't always crystal clear and isn't always a sound one: the difference between procedure and substance. Procedure is composed of the rules that and process through which somebody in our legal system will often go. So when you take the civil procedure course, you learn a lot about the federal rules of civil procedure, which govern when and how somebody makes a filing. States also have rules that are very similar to the federal system. Those are procedures, right? Criminal law, it doesn't have the word substance in the title, but it's there. This is not a course about those processes. It's about the scope of our law. In other words, what we decide is criminal and what we decide is not criminal, right? How things are punished and what should be punished. So the substance of criminal law is the almost exclusive focus of this course. With that being said, it's good to know a few basic procedures. So in the casebook, you actually see a very complicated diagram that was made in the middle of the 20th century by some criminologists who wanted to have a more systemic understanding of our system. And it showed all the different sort of inflows and outflows and how a criminal case is resolved. You don't need to know all that. It's enough to get the basic picture there, right? That somebody is arrested, somebody is prosecuted, they're found guilty or innocent, or not guilty, I should say. And then there are potentially appeals as well. Also in the casebook, there is a depiction of what's called a crime funnel, which is a criminological term for describing the way cases move through the system. And the funnel shrinks as it proceeds, meaning there's fewer and fewer cases at each step. This is because not every case is going to be appealed, right? Not every arrest is even going to result in a prosecution. And so this course is going to read a lot of appeals. And as I mentioned in the text, those are not always representative. The cases that get appealed are not the same that result, you know, they don't always embody or accurately represent fully all the cases where there was a crime was reported, there was an arrest, there were charges filed. But I've tried to pick them appropriately, and we also do look at some cases that never moved beyond, say, the arrest stage, or for which a not guilty verdict. But the nature of law school is we have to focus on the law that is across the board, and appellate courts are often a good embodiment of that, right? It's not perfect. Not every law trickles down in the same way throughout the system. But that is something you need to know about how our system works, that general process, that general pattern. And then, as the slide here indicates, you need to know the process or the rules that govern how somebody is found guilty. Because if we're going to look at appeals, we need to know, well, what was the standard, what was the rule by which a person was found guilty in the trial? And, of course, you know the phrase reasonable doubt or beyond a reasonable doubt. What it means, though, however, is a little less clear. And Victor v. Nebraska was one of the more recent cases where the U.S. Supreme Court laid out what it meant. And if you read the case, if you read the questions, it's not crystal clear. It's a phrase that by its very nature is not exact or precise. You can't boil it down. Or at least the courts have said you shouldn't boil it down to a percentage, right? You wouldn't say I'm 99% sure, therefore it's beyond a reasonable doubt. Rather, it's defined through other words and other phrases that also lack precision. And this was a case that the Nebraska Supreme Court had reviewed some instructions that were given to the jurors about what beyond a reasonable doubt meant. And then the U.S. Supreme Court is reviewing that Nebraska High Court opinion. Now, the exact phrases that were used here are not that important. I'm not going to have you all examine a jury instruction and say, oh, does this meet the Supreme Court standard? Rather, what I want you to gain from this lesson is that it's a really high burden, right? The phrases that were used in there may have not been perfect matches. Right, the court did say substantial doubt may be problematic, but in the context it was used by the trial court, it was okay. And strong probabilities is probably a good phrase, but it doesn't give us much more information than we already had from reasonable doubt. So we want to know, one, it's a high burden, and two, it's not just any doubt. So, you know, if somebody is accused of murder, multiple witnesses at the scene said it was this person. They were found with the gun in their hand. They had their fingerprints were on the gun. They'd written messages that said, I'm going to kill you, and delivered them to the victim. They had put on their calendar, kill such and such today. They're caught on video, right? There's tons and tons of evidence. And the defendant gets up and says, well, it wasn't me. It was an alien doppelganger. It was an alien who can change form, assume my identity, and they are actually the one who did it. They have the same fingerprints. They read all these messages. Well, at that point, yeah, that's arguably a doubt, if you're a juror, but it's not a reasonable one, right? It's not one that a reasonable person would hold. So the key in understanding reasonable doubt is that it's a very high burden, but it's not the elimination of all doubts, things that are crazy or far-fetched or conspiratorial. And so that's just something to keep in mind because we're going to be looking at reviews of guilty verdicts. So you need to know the original standard, and then we're going to talk as we go through the cases what the standard that the appellate court uses about whether they should defer to that jury verdict. And so those will be the primary primary teaching tools throughout the semester. We're going to look at those sorts of cases. But I want to give you one other note, which I mentioned in the text, but I also want to highlight here that the cases we read and analyze in criminal law serve a slightly different function than in many different law school courses. The focus of a criminal law case is not to find the case that embodies a universal rule. That'll happen sometimes. That actually is true of Victor v. Nebraska because it's interpreting our Constitution, and our Constitution governs all jurisdictions at the state and federal level. But most of the time, we're looking at cases from a single jurisdiction, usually a state, and it may not even be the state's highest court. And so it's not even a controlling rule for the entire state. So why would we look at such cases? Well, the key aspect is the cases are good illustrations. They'll illustrate a legal rule that I want you to understand. They'll have a fact pattern sometimes that just really shows how a rule would work because it just has all the facts that hit the right notes and intersect with the statute in the right way. So it's important, other than our few constitutional cases, which we just have peppered here and there throughout the semester, the primary focus of you in reading these cases is to say, this is an illustration of a concept. This is an illustration of a rule, and it's not a universal one. Related to this problem of jurisdictions and related to how to read the cases, we do have two general approaches to criminal law in the United States, but they're not these separate categories where you'd say, okay, some jurisdictions follow rule A and some follow rule B. Instead, it's more of a mix. So I've highlighted this in the text, and I'm just going to give you a little information now, but it's something you need to keep in mind going forward. So when the United States broke away from England, it had a problem, which is suddenly there's no criminal law. We've broken away from the country that's the basis for our law. And so there was a rather quick decision made. Well, let's just keep that English law, right? And this is the English common law, meaning at this time it's mostly derived from judicial opinions and certain other aspects of government, but they're not codified in statutes. And so we call this the common law tradition. Now, over time in the United States, we stop paying attention to these English cases as much, and we do something else, which is we write them down and we make them statutory in nature. And so we refer to common law derived criminal law as the statutes that have a basis in this sort of common law tradition, but themselves aren't really judicial law anymore. Instead, they're written and codified into statutes. And statutes are a big focus of what this course is about. The second category and the second approach of law in the United States stems from the Model Penal Code. And the Model Penal Code was an effort in the middle of the, well, little, middle of the 20th century, a little earlier than that, but that's when it culminated, to craft an ideal sort of modern criminal law set of statutes that could then be adopted by any state. Because the Model Penal Code was written by a private organization. It includes a lot of, and it did include and does include a lot of judges, practitioners, professors, people who have an interest in what the particular aspects that are being discussed on any given day would be brought in. And so it's meant to be an expert-generated criminal justice system. But no state adopted the Model Penal Code in its entirety. Almost every state took a decent chunk of it, took little bits and pieces, and used it to reform their law. But for the most part, we just have a group of governments in the United States that has different combinations of the Model Penal Code and common law approach. And so throughout our course and throughout the textbook, you will hear me talk and read text that says, well, this is the common law approach, or this is the Model Penal Code approach. But you'll notice in lots of the cases, there's not a there's some mixing in going on, that you'll see a common law jurisdiction that says, well, we kind of adopted this part of the model penal code, and this is how it affects the opinion. And this can be complicated, but it is important for you throughout the semester to sort of keep two boxes in your head. One is the common law-derived approach, and one is the model penal code approach. And from time to time, I'll tell you, there's two different approaches there. Other times I'll say, well, no, really, they're on the same page here. And so these are the basics of the substance of American criminal law. We're going to talk over the next few classes about what should be criminalized, what should be punished, on what basis do we decide what should be punished and what should be criminalized. But for now, I just wanted to lay out the very, very basic introduction to this course, this series of lectures, and to American criminal justice. So that's it for today.